Councillors, ladies and gentlemen, in the unlikely event of the fire alarm being activated, please leave the town hall using the nearest designated fire exit to form up on the assembly points at the mayor and exchange flags. Kindly ensure all our loved ones are switched off.
Apologies for absence have been received from Councillors Lila Bennett, Paul Brandt, Dave Cummins, Alan Tormey, Pauline Walton, Laura Robertson-Collins, Tom Cardwell, Maureen Delahunty and Lisa Gore. Are there any further apologies to report?
Lord Mayor, Councillor Cansoy.
Lord Mayor, Sarah Morton has just tested positive for COVID.
Thank you. Can I advise members that Chris Walsh, Assistant Director for Governance, Audit and Assurance, and long-standing officer of our Democratic Services team, is not present tonight as he is recovering from a recent operation. I therefore ask all members to join me in wishing Chris a full and speedy recovery, and we look forward to seeing his return at the heart of the action at the earliest opportunity. Also, can I inform members that John Ord, a former councillor of Speke Ward, passed away in November, and on behalf of the council, we send our condolences to his family on their sad loss. Can I also remind members that the council is seeking your views through our member survey. Giving everyone the chance to have their say is incredibly important as we continue our strategic improvement journey. The survey contains a wide range of questions for members to answer, and the responses will help to shape our direction of travel. All responses are confidential. The survey is being run by an independent company to help preserve anonymity. Please check your available emails for a link to the survey, and paper copies will also be available for completion. And now I'll talk about my time as Lord Mayor of the best city on earth. Where do I even begin? There's so many thank yous I've got to do. I want to thank every child I've met this year. From the little boy that said, "Are you dead rich?" And I said, "No, I'm not." And his little mate, as you like, said, "Yeah, well, how much have you got then?" So I said £9.60. It was a scoop of my award that evening on Facebook. I was getting messages off mums that are now saying, "Mary, do you need a few? I've got a fiver if you need it. You can pay me back when you've got more than £9.60. The senior residents that I've met have been incredible. Not as much fun as the kids, but still incredible. The community groups, you know, I could speak about the Chinese community, the Jewish community, the Yemeni community. They made me so, so welcome. They fed me, and I should be 20 stone. I'm not kidding you, I mean they fed and they fed me. The charities that I've met, I've been humbled by the work that they do across the city. The civics that I've met, the chain gang, you can imagine, the Lord Lieutenant and the High Sheriff, just the nicest people. And they took me under the wing and sort of protected me from a lot of things. The churches, from the archbishops, to the priests, to the vicars, just incredible. And they do our city proud. I mean, the list is endless, but I have to say thank you, and I think it's the biggest thank you of all, to the town hall staff. I don't know whether you're all aware of the work that Ian Jones does to set up civic events. are bettered by nobody in this country. The work is incredible. Gemma, who looked after my diary, God help that girl, she has been marvellous. The young men that have driven me, put the chains on me, guided me, it's been like having extra, I know. I'll rephrase that at some time in the future. You know what I meant there. Seriously, you know what I meant. It's been like, I've got one son, and it's been like having four or five extra sons for the year. I can't thank them enough. Democratic Services, for getting me through some tough days. You all know the tough days I'm talking about. I thank them. Tony, the chief exec, and his team of senior management for guiding me through stuff, for being there, for supporting me. I thank you as well. Councillors from every group, and I mean this genuinely, you have all had me back for me, and I thank you all for that. My family, again, I don't know how they put up with me for the last 9 months. Especially my son as consort and my daughter as Lady Mayoress. They've been absolute stars. And I'll finish with my charity volunteers who have helped me raise phenomenal amounts of money so far. I've still got 3 months to raise a few more, Bob. But thank you all for putting your faith in me, for letting me do this job. I owe you big time. Thank you. To speak.
Thank you, Mary. As at your last meeting, I wanted to say a few words about the 9 months that you've had. From exchanging plaques with brand new cruise ships and welcoming Olympic athletes to our wonderful city, to inspiring a new generation of Scousers to champion our city and their communities. You started the year chairing these meetings in the tennis centre with your backdrop, in Everton Lifestyles, and you'll enter it in the right home, the home of our local democracy. You've persevered with us through our global pandemic and still managed to steer us through some tricky times and sometimes fraught meetings. I promise to be on my best behaviour tonight because I would never like to hear you call me to the parlour. Harry mentioned to me earlier that when you both boarded the MSC Geoso last June, everyone coming off the ships which bore the city were in awe of seeing you in all your glory and don't be worried about it. Your warmth, humour and true scouse grit made sure every one of those visitors came off the ship knowing what the true sense of what our city meant to us and what we had to offer. When I think of Liverpool as Lord Mayor, I think of Liverpool. You are Liverpool to the core. And not only have you been an amazing ambassador for our city, you continue to be an amazing ambassador for your ward, Steve Garston. I know your charity is incredibly proud and thankful for the support and platform you've given this year. All charities are rooted in your community. And Lord Mayor, we're going to miss you in the chair, but most importantly, I'm quite telling your character. I know the staff that you've worked with, particularly the town hall staff, I really going to miss you too. You've absolutely loved working with you. So Lord Mayor, thank you both to you and your wonderful council for your service to the city, and I hope you both enjoyed your time, and I'm sure you'll see you in another friend.
Thank you, Joanne. Can I invite Councillor Richard Kemp to speak?
My old man, I'm afraid I can't get out of my head this picture of young man pulling your chain, but I will do my best to overcome that. You are the 39th Lord Mayor of Liverpool I have been privileged to serve under. Every single one of them has been a credit to this city because they played to their own strengths. I've only ever been scared of one lawmare, and I think those of you that know who I'm referring to. But when you've had cause to discipline me and to bring me in, you've done so with charm, dignity, and a joke which brought me swiftly to heel. And it's those qualities that you've taken out into the city. Of course, people have respectfully called you Lord Mayor, but they've also known that you're Mary, a daughter of this city through and through, proud of your roots, proud of your city. And as I've watched you interacting with the great and good and the not so good, you've treated them all alike and you've treated them all as our first citizen should. The humour and the friendliness that you display has really shown you as a first-class Lord Mayor, because that's the person that you are. My Lord Mayor, you've still got 3 months to go. I hope you enjoy every minute of it. And I thank you on behalf of my group for all the work you've done over the first 9 months of your tenure in office. Thank you, my Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Richard. That means a lot. Can I invite Councillor Steve Radford to speak?
I'm not one for telling tales, but on this case, I will. Last night I got a phone call from a long-standing friend of ours who said he'd been to a council reception, and the point of the conversation was he met the Lord Mayor on the town hall step to have a sneaky cigarette during the event. And I think he actually summed up, it was really great to have a Lord Mayor who's one of us. So I couldn't have any more comment to your service and your character than what my friend said. Mary, you're one of the city. People love having one of us in Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Steve. Can I invite Councillor Tom Crone to speak?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. From the bottom of my heart, thank you for the service you've provided this city for the last 9 months. An obvious pride of representing Liverpool and pride in your city is absolutely clear for all to see. And you've always chaired these meetings with, you know, a good bit of authority, but also with humour and fairness at all times. So thank you very much and enjoy the last 3 months.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, all of you, for your kind words. It does mean a lot to me.
Lord Mayor, do any members have any disclosable pecuniary or prejudicial interests in any of the items on the agenda tonight? If so, you are required to declare the interest and leave the meeting during the consideration of the item. Members are advised that the obligation to pay the council tax is not a disclosable pecuniary or prejudicial interest under the Code of Conduct for the purposes of setting the council tax or budget. Does any member need to declare an interest under the Code of Conduct?
Councillor Doyle.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I've declared a disclosable pecuniary interest in item 5 because I have a contract of employment with Liverpool College and they'll receive funds if the capital programme is approved by Cabinet and by the Council tonight. I will withdraw for that item. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Parsons.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I disclose pecuniary interest in agenda item number 5 by virtue of my employment in the Shorestown Centre, please?
Thank you, Councillor.
Lord Mayor, secondly, under Section 106 of the Local Government and Finance Act 1992, if an amount due in respect of your council tax has not been paid for at least 2 months after it became payable, then you must now declare that interest and you cannot vote on any matter concerning the setting of council tax precepts or limitation of council tax and precepts, the setting of the budget, or the administration or enforcement matters in relation to council tax. These are the decisions made in items 5A to D. It's a criminal offence to fail to make a declaration or to vote on this item when in arrears of council tax as described. Does any member wish to make a declaration of arrears of council tax which has been due for a period of 2 months or more?
Can I move that the minutes of the ordinary City Council meeting held on the 26th of January 2022 be approved? Is that agreed? We move to item three, public question time. Can I advise council that we have two speakers this evening? The first speaker wishes to address us in relation to the budget recommendation for 2022 to 23. Can I therefore invite Ruth Knox to address the council for up to 3 minutes?
And in particular Labour councillors, not to pass a cuts budget. I think one figure out of the many that you're aware of, that since 2010 we have lost 65% in real terms of our budget. So in other words, you this year are being asked to meet the same needs and in fact greater needs, and you're being asked to do it on 35% of the budget you had in 2010. That's not possible. Every single year since 2011, there has been a cut in Liverpool's funding. Every single year, we've been told that the council has to make difficult decisions, and every single year, the justification for making those cuts has been that it's better than they're made by a Labour council than by the Tory government or even by commissioners. But we have reached a point where that argument can't stand up. We've reached a point where there's no decisions really to be made about what's left to cut. The cuts that this council will vote through tonight, if you do vote them through, will be pretty much the same cuts that the Tories or any other group would make. And as for the commissioners, of course they're here already. And I have a strong suspicion that this budget would not be going forward unless the commissioners were in fact happy with it. So if the cut, their cuts would really not be significantly different from the budget that it is. But the problem is, so long as the council makes the cuts, it legitimises them and it legitimises the Tory project, which is to hollow out local government and local government services until they do not exist at all. When I was reading over the consultation, there was a bit where it said, how will we achieve these cuts? We will manage demand. We will manage demand. We will manage demand. In other words, the citizens of this city expect too much, and we will have to lower their expectations. That is the Tory project. To lower our expectations, to lower our demands until we expect nothing at all. And I know that councillors don't want to do it, but I'm appealing to them not to go along with that. When I read over the council plan, there was loads of brilliant aspirations. There were to do with raising education achievement, to do with reducing social isolation, with the 20-minute city. Now, aspirations aren't achieved by wanting them to be achieved or by writing them down. They cannot ever be achieved without the resources. That's the Tory line, and it can't happen. How can you raise education?
Ruth, can I ask you to bring it to a close? Your 3 minutes are up.
Thank you, and I hope you'll be slightly It's likely jealous to me, and I'm coming to the close. How can you raise educational standards by reducing library provision? How can you reduce social isolation by using a phone call instead of a person to see somebody in care, or even reducing their care completely? How can you have a 20-minute sitting if you close the one-stop shops? That's such a very valued service. So I am urging councillors now to say to the government, enough is enough. Do your own dirty work. We will not make these cuts. And if you did that, it could be the start of a campaign that would really manage demand. But it would be the other way around. It would be you demanding for this city the money it needs. If not now, when? Thank you.
Thank you, Ruth. Mayor Joanne, would you like to respond?
Thank you for coming and contributing on behalf of Liverpool against the cuts. Ruth, you know me and you know what I'm about. We've both supported the same people. You know the challenging situation that some of our residents face. You know that a death of a relative or a fallout from a family member can push people into depression. We know people who can't open letters that come through the door for months at a time because they can't face the debt that they're in through not being able to pay the rent or the council tax. And we know that a washing machine breaking down can push people into furniture poverty. We know that a sanction from the DWP can mean that some people never have enough money and have to choose between these or these. And you know, as we do as Labour members, that the funds that we give in the form of Liverpool Assistance Support Scheme or the discretionary housing payments and the funding that we give our community groups and advice agencies support those people to give them the leg up they need to turn their situation around. And I'm proud to lead this group that have implemented this support for most of our vulnerable residents despite our local government grants being cut by 65% since 2011. The budget we have delivered in trying circumstances is caused by the continued drastic reduction in funding by this Tory government. And in response to your specific queries, we are delivering over and above our statutory obligations for children's services, and we will open two residential children's homes this year. Our red line is that we always prioritise support for the most vulnerable in our community. The proposal we put forward today represents a robust and legal budget for the city. And I would remind you that the cuts that are being forced to make this budget are due to the huge and unjust reductions in the funding imposed by the Tory government. But as a council, we will fight for the greater funding and resources, and we will continue to do so for the people of this city.
Thank you, Mayor Joanne. All of us present tonight have seen the tragic events unfolding in Ukraine. As Lord Mayor, I have therefore accepted an additional motion to ensure full council can clearly express its views and crucially offer support to the people of Ukraine. I propose that we consider the motion now, and that as an urgent item, I will only be permitting the Mayor, group leaders and Councillor Kushner to comment as movers, given the impact of the Ukraine on the Ukrainian community in Liverpool. I have also agreed to allow a representative of the community to address us this evening. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Our next speaker wishes to address us in relation to the urgent motion on the crisis in Ukraine. Can I welcome Pastor Taras, who is a representative of Liverpool's UK Ukrainian community, to the meeting. He will now address us for up to 3 minutes.
Councillors, guests, Thank you so much for inviting me to speak today on behalf of the Ukrainian community. Our community in Great Britain has history in Northwest. Recently, it celebrated 100 years since the first immigrants from Ukraine arrived. In June, the Ukrainian Catholic Church will be marking the 75th anniversary of the establishment of our church structures here. In Liverpool, Ukrainian presence is rather modest. There are about 5-6 families attending regular church services. But it's a very nice, open, welcoming and growing community. We hold monthly services at St. Edward's, St. Oswald's and St. Sebastian's Roman Catholic Parish. And we are very grateful to the Archbishop and the local Roman Catholic Parish for welcoming us. So today many of our sisters and brothers in Ukraine have to defend their country against Russian aggression. And this is a war of values. A war for the most fundamental values of freedom, human dignity and democracy, and a war against these values. There are no words to express thoughts and emotions about what has been going on in the last few days. It all feels completely surreal for me. The local Ukrainian community is shattered. But it assembled last Saturday night and we prayed. And we have been moved by so many expressions of support and prayers here in Liverpool, elsewhere in the UK, and coming from other parts of the world. So today I would like to ask all of you, pray for Ukraine, find ways to help people who suffer, regardless of the political views and personal convictions. Solidarity with the victim is always the right choice. We need to do everything to protect innocent people who cry out for our help. I ask you all, let us stand all together in unity and in solidarity with Ukraine in this difficult moment. I thank you very much.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Council condemns the unprovoked invasion of Ukraine by the Russian Federation and the illegal act of international aggression, which again sees the spectre of war cast a shadow over Europe and across all the peaceful, democratic and free nations of the world. It's now the seventh day since Russia invaded Ukraine, and we've all watched in disbelief as the horrific events of the past week have unfolded. Liverpool has a proud history of providing sanctuary and welcome to people from Ukraine since the beginning of the last century. We have Ukrainian and Polish communities who have made Liverpool their home. We can only hope, imagine how worrying this time is for the families, especially if you still have loved ones in Ukraine. We stand in solidarity and will do everything we can to support. This act of war has caused untold suffering, and Ukraine will continue to be in our hearts, minds and prayers for the people of Liverpool. We can only hope for peace, unity and resolution in the coming days and weeks. We've earmarked reserves to support people who are fleeing the situation, and we've set up a GoFundMe page that will be available in the next couple of days to help support people. We have local organisations giving all the pledging their support, and we have provided information and updates when they come in so that everybody can do what they can to support.
Thank you, Mayor Joanne. I'm advised that the motion is to be seconded and supported by the group leaders, and I will ask each in turn to address council. Councillor Richard Kemp.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. I can't tell you how proud I am to be meeting in the Town Hall today under the flag of the Ukraine, which is flying above this building. I'm a member of a small group that produces podcasts for the Liberal Democrats. And on Monday, we were supposed to be doing podcasts about council tax. Instead, we were honoured to be joined by someone called Kira Rudick, who is the leader of one of the two Liberal parties in the Ukraine, the leader of the biggest party, being President Zelensky himself. Kira told us what she'd been doing the previous Friday. She'd been learning to use a Kalashnikov. She made it clear that she, like most Ukrainians, were prepared to die alongside their president if that was what it took to save their country. I can only hope that Kira is alive. I can only hope that when the words, "Don't send me a ticket, send me ammunition," are inscribed on President Zelensky's tombstone, it is not for many, many years. My Lord Mayor, you were present, as I was, just 6 months ago when we welcomed the Russian ambassador and a naval detachment to this city. We did so to commemorate the Arctic convoys, which went from Liverpool to keep the Eastern Front supplied, and particularly Russia, with the food they needed, the sanitary and health supplies they needed, and the ammunition they needed to stay in World War II. We stood together then against a common aggressor. But I must say, my Lord Mayor, that today our one-time partner has become the aggressor with an aerial bombardment and a tank deployment and a missile deployment which is just as bad as the Nazi blitzkrieg against Poland in 1939. That's why we twinned with the eastern Ukrainian port of Odessa in 1957. When I first got on the council, we used to do all sorts of things with Odessa. That's one of the things we ought to take up, is trying to renew that link. I just think there are two things that we can do today, and I'm grateful that this has come down. Firstly, we can honour those who are fighting and dying for their democracy, because when they do so, they're fighting and dying for our democracy as well. And as the elected mayor has indicated, we've got to consider what practical things we can do. Yes, let's get in touch with the mayor of Odessa. Let's work out how we can send food there and the other supplies they need. Let's work out if they're allowed to come to this country. And I think we don't want to be political about this, but our government is not playing this well in terms of dealing with refugees from an allied country. Where we can house them, how we can house them, and how we can give them the support they deserve and we want to give them. As I said before, today the flag of Ukraine flies over this town hall. Today it is our flag as well. It should remain raised and honoured until the Russians have been driven back and Ukraine is once more a free country. I'm proud to support this motion.
councillor. Councillor to Crone.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm proud to support this motion as well, and I'm proud that here in Liverpool we all stand shoulder to shoulder with the people of Ukraine. Russia's unprovoked aggression against a peaceful, democratic nation is a tragedy. It's a tragedy for the Ukrainians, but it's a tragedy for all of us, because it makes us realise how fragile our democracies could be. We must all heed President Zelensky's calls for help and do everything we possibly can to help the people of Ukraine and help make sure that Putin is driven out of Ukraine. I'd like to praise the people of Liverpool as ever. They're showing so much support for people who need that support. In particular, members of the Polish community who've organised collections of all sorts of necessary items that are going to be transported across there at the weekend. I've taken a carload of things that I've collected up there on Friday, and I'm looking at those people who are doing such heroic work. And I agree with Richard's comment that we should strengthen our ties again with Odessa, reignite that twinning that we have with that city, and find out how we can support them and how we can build links with Odessa. And another thing we need to do is we need to urge the government to accept all Ukrainian refugees, no sort of measly offer of a few family members. Any Ukrainian refugee must be welcome here in Britain. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Steve Radford.
He came for Georgia and the world looked aside. He came for Crimea and the world looked aside. And at the moment, we're sending armaments, which is good, I have to say, to the credit of the United Kingdom and the government of Canada, and one of the first to put emergency shipments through. Many of our politicians across the world, not just the UK, have been scared of taking Russia on because they don't want to start World War III. I'm going to express a personal view. World War III has started. The difference is the Ukrainians are fighting and we are watching. I have absolutely no qualms. I support all the other speakers in respect. I think the government has been slow and tardy over their Ukrainian refugee system. Let us not repeat mistakes of the past. Do we not remember when Britain turned back ships of Jewish families trying to reach the United Kingdom from Nazi Germany? World War III has started, and we should actually immediately disconnect any relationships with the Russian Federation. They are playing the same theme tunes, the same narratives and the same tactics that Nazi Germany did when they started their rollout across Czechoslovakia, Sudetenland, Austria and then later Poland. We will have to stand up for some time, and we in the West need prepared to stand up to them, and the sooner we do so, the quicker we will actually have democracy and freedom restored for everybody, and defend our own, because if we don't, where will the tanks roll next? The Baltic Republics, Finland, previously a duchy of the Tsarist Empire, Georgia, an independent state that's already had enclaves eaten out of it. We need to call the bluff, and we need to stand for democracy. And we shouldn't just leave the Ukrainians alone to do it.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Barry Kushner was a mover and has played a key role in bringing this forward. So I will allow Barry to speak as well.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. I'm grateful that you suspended standing orders to allow us to recognise and express the voice of the city in condemnation of what's going on. I think like so many people, could see it building, but to see it actually happening and tanks rolling into cities in a very old-fashioned kind of war in the motorways, it's been shocking. And it's shocking to see it, you know, rolling out every day, the messages and images that circulate on social media and the TV and the media, in with people and families and children having to escape the bombing and the sounds of missiles and the destruction of their cities in underground stations, car parks, parts of their flats where there are no windows, no glass, so they can go there when the sirens start to go off. It's and of course we've got to condemn what Putin is doing. Russia, it's not the first time Russia has hurt and damaged, caused pain in the Ukraine. Let's do it again. But you know, we know that Ukrainians are defiant people. The defiant people. And this won't pass easily. We saw that in 2014 when for 93 days, unarmed, they started off as just protesters against the government that didn't want to take a stand around having a vote to join the EU. For 93 days, he stood out in the Maidan revolution in the centre of Kiev. Some people who support Liverpool had been walking across only a couple of years ago. Even in the face of snipers, some of whom were from the Russian military that was sent to Kiev to prop up that Russian-backed regime. So even if Moscow, Russian forces take Kyiv, Kharkiv, Kherson, or the other cities in Ukraine, that would be the end of it. Because I don't believe that Ukrainian people are going to stop there. They will continue to fight this. And that's why it's important for us that we make the commitment to support refugees and people from Ukraine. This is going to take a long time. And past the homage, probably, you know, there's probably more people connected to the Ukraine than he thinks he knows. But, you know, my family, as the mayor referred to before, my family was one of those that came here in 1914 and got sanctuary in the city.